In the name of Allah, the Beneficent, the Merciful, we give him praise and we thank him for his blessings, his gifts, his undeserved kindness to the human family. We thank him for the gift of life, and as you know, and I think you'll agree with me, that one thing is to have life, and another thing is to know how to live the life that God has given. We thank Allah for all of his prophets and messengers who came with guidance that we might be successful during the time that we spend in the circle of life. We thank him for Abraham, we thank him for Moses, we thank him for Jesus, and we thank him for Muhammad. Peace be upon these worthy servants of Almighty God, Allah. As a student and follower of the Honorable Elijah Muhammad, I could never thank Allah enough for his intervention in our affairs in the person of Master Farad Muhammad and his raising up from among us a divine leader, teacher, and guide in the personage of the Most Honorable Elijah Muhammad. I thank Allah each and every day for the man that we are about to behold and hear from again today by the grace of God. He is a divine leader, a divine teacher, and he certainly is a divine guide. The man that I speak of is none other than the Honorable Minister Louis Farrakhan. I greet all of you, my dear, beloved brothers and sisters, in the greeting words of peace. We say it in the Arabic language, Assalamu alaikum. Brothers and sisters, I think our national spokesman deserves another warm round of applause for his witness. And brothers and sisters, we're very fortunate again to have the man of God in our midst. And I feel that I must remind us that Allah hates ingratitude. And it was in 1972, during the Theology of Time lecture series that the Honorable Elijah Muhammad was coming out every week. He was not in the best of health, but he gained the strength that he needed to come out and deliver a word to a people that he loved and wanted to see saved from their condition. And it was during this period that the faith in many people's hearts, especially those who say they believe, began to wane. And we begin to question the purpose for which we committed our lives to. We began to entertain really wicked and evil thoughts, and ingratitude ended up becoming, I believe, in my study, the very thing that caused Allah to take his servant from us. We can't repeat history, brothers and sisters. We only get one chance at this. We only have one life to live. And tomorrow's not guaranteed to any of us. So when we know that Allah has intervened in our affairs and is giving himself to us, let us please be mindful that we should always show our appreciation. Satan has captured most of the people, and he will bring all that he has in the last day to oppose God's messenger and to take the minds of the people away from that word of guidance. Today we have entertainment, much of it. Movies and sport and play to distract our minds. Here is our beloved minister. Help me to receive the Honorable Minister Louis Farrakhan. Allahu Akbar. Allahu Akbar. Allahu Akbar. All praise is due to Allah for the Honorable Minister Louis Farrakhan. Allahu Akbar. Allahu Akbar.
In the name of Allah, the Beneficent, the Merciful, we give him praise and thanks for his goodness and his mercy to the human family, and for his sending of prophets and messengers to bring us the guidance and to teach us more and more knowledge of ourselves and himself. I thank him for his raising up among us the most honorable Elijah Muhammad as our divine leader, teacher, and guide. Needless to say, I don't like to see empty seats because there's nothing more important than our people receiving that which Allah has revealed for our salvation, which means that on each of us, we have a duty, we have a responsibility. If we love the truth and love Allah and love our people, we always want to share with them what has been shared with us, that we might better ourselves and our people. No matter what you do in the cause of truth, the best thing you can do is to bring another human being to that which will absolutely save and better their lives. So I never want to see that you came to get a drink of water and pass by thirsty people and did not bring them to get a drink with you. That's rather selfish, isn't it? So each of you that came, I thank you. But I would have been so much happier if you thought enough to bring someone with you. But be that as it may, I have prepared something for you. And I must say this to you, you know. I don't know why this morning somehow something didn't feel right. And I had not been able to shake that feeling. And maybe this is why. The thing that I wanted to talk about today is a subject that the Most Honorable Elijah Muhammad said, if black people really understood the truth about Jesus, we would be free overnight. I want you to just think about those words. If we only understood the truth about Jesus, we would be free overnight. Why? In Jewish, Christian, and Islamic literature. Jesus is a most important person. The Jews do not believe that the man who came here 2,000 years ago was in fact the Messiah. So the Jews, to this very day, disbelieve in Jesus, not only as a Messiah, but they refuse to believe in him even as a prophet of God. The Muslims, on the other hand, believe that Jesus was a prophet, and the Muslims also believe, according to the teachings of the Holy Quran, that Jesus was Messiah. And the Muslims teach that Jesus would come again, and that they would see him in the judgment, and he would be with the man that the Muslims are looking for, called the Mahdi, the one who comes to guide humanity back to the path of God after Satan's power to rule has been crushed. Jesus is so important, I mean the real truth of him, is so important because of the power and the truth that Allah would give him to end Satan's rule. It is natural then that Satan would work very hard to deceive the masses of the people with respect to Jesus. Because to tell the truth of Jesus would end Satan's power to rule. Now, you have to understand, Satan is trying to preserve his power, and his power is in his ability to deceive. And the greatest deceit is to deceive you about the man you expect to be your savior. Now, I mentioned last week four Jesuses that today I would, with the help of Allah, bring you the knowledge of four entities that are under that name Jesus. And why the name Jesus is so important. Okay? Now, if you take this Bible, and I know most of you young people and brothers and sisters, this book has symbolic meaning. We respect it because our parents respect it or our grandparents respect it, but we never respected it enough to read it. And so we really don't know a lot about what's in the book, but we say, oh yeah, the Bible, that's a good book. Well, you know, if somebody told you that a book was good and you started talking about the book being good, then somebody asked you, well, what's in the book? And then you can't say nothing because you never read the book. Well, yeah, but I heard my mama talk about it. I heard my pastor talk about it. I heard on the television other people talking about it. Yeah, I know. But brother, people talking about it and you experiencing it by reading it yourself, is an entire different thing. But since we don't like to read, then of course we're at a disadvantage, because we're always depending upon somebody else to tell us something. And if they choose to tell us the truth, that's good. And if they don't choose to tell us the truth, we would never be able to defeat the lie, because we never study to find the truth ourselves. So I want to help us today to really look at this Bible, Quran, and see that truth is there, but it's not readily discernible. There are truths that you can read and instantly have an understanding of, but there are other parts of both the Bible and Holy Quran that we need help to understand it. Why? Because the prophets revealed what they revealed, and some of it was allegorical, some of it was parables, some of it was things to come in the future put in strange ways. So if you don't really dig and study, you may not come to understand. And even if you dig and study, it would take God Himself to help us to understand the way the scripture has been put, as a protection and also as an enemy who had it in his hand and wanting to confuse the persons who would read it. So today we want to try simply to unravel some beauty here that will make you feel very good about Jesus, and most important, very good about yourself. Now, if we start our study today to look for the keys of the Bible and the Quran, you would look for one. Where's God? Two, who are the people of God? Three, who is that special messenger of God? And why is Jesus the most important person of the scripture? If you start at the Genesis, you see God making a man and the man messing up. And ever since that man messed up, there's been a big mess up on the planet. And ever since there has been a mess up, meaning man has and woman have fallen from the place that God intended for us, God has always sent prophets into the world from time to time to reform, to explain, to guide, to warn, and to prophesy of things to come. Prophets became necessary when Satan causes man to fall. Somebody has to come to help man and woman get back up where God intended us to be. Those persons are called prophets, messengers of God. They're called reformers. But none of these prophets had the power to overcome Satan's world. So even if a prophet came and did good work, Satan still kept his power. The prophet may have gotten a few to believe and straighten up their lives, but he never could overcome Satan. And that's why this fella named Jesus is so important, because Jesus is the first one that comes that gets a victory over Satan, and then he opens the way for everybody to overcome Satan. Now, in the past, you have been looking at Satan as a spirit. But spirits can't deceive you. Every spirit is in something of material. If you've ever been deceived, you've been deceived by somebody with a bad spirit. Is that right? So you can't think that Satan is some giant spirit out here deceiving people. People cannot be deceived except by people. So the first thing you got to understand is, when God comes, he has to reveal Satan. And when he pulls the cover off of Satan, then you say, whoa, I've been looking at this dude and didn't know who he was. But I knew he wasn't good. But each one of these prophets that come, they give us signs of what the Messiah would look like and the work that he would do on the coming of God. Now this, I'm going to try to move fast, and I don't want you to think that I'm talking in a spooky kind of way. Because usually religion makes people think in spook terms. Spirits. No. Ain't no spirit put this world in the condition that this world is in, buddy. And it's no spirit that's going to get us out of this condition. You have to have the spirit, all right, but the spirit has to be in a container. A human being that is clothed or wrapped or in the embodiment of the Spirit of God. Now, Satan's time of rule is called a time of darkness. That's an interesting symbolic expression. Now, just think about darkness. Now, it was sunny this morning, right? But when we were on the way to the mosque, the clouds had formed, and you couldn't really see the sun, but it don't make any difference. Even though the sun is not physically seen, the fact that it is there makes the day sun brighter than any one of these lights. Daylight is something. See, in the night, you can make a mistake in looking at something and not knowing what you're looking at. But when the sun comes up, you see a thing as it is. So if Satan's time of rule is a time of darkness, then in darkness you never see things as they really are. So under the darkness of Satan's rule, you don't see yourself, you don't see your brother, you don't see God, You don't see life as you should. So it takes the coming of God and the turning on of the light to allow you to see clearly that which you misunderstood in the darkness of last night. This book, Qur'an, calls this period of Satan's rule a time of darkness, and it talks about how God alternates night and day, and in it is a sign for those who would be reflective. But it also calls this period of Satan's dominance a transitory life, meaning when you're in this period, you're in transit. You're not where you were, and you're not where you're gonna be. In other words, you're on the L train. You're going someplace, coming from someplace. But the question that you need to know is, where did you come from? And where are you going, since the world that you're living in is called a transitory life? Then the Quran calls it a life of sport and play. And what this means is that during this period of Satan's rule, the human being would never reach his or her full potential. Because the life of the world in which you live is not designed to bring you to your full potential. It is designed to keep you on a certain level where you can never deal with the ruler of this world. You will always be under his power. The moment you start coming to that which will free you and bring you to your full potential, Satan's power over you has been diminished. Now, sport and play. That's what the world is like. This is why, right now, it's playoff time in basketball and in hockey, and I guess getting ready for other sport. One season of sport ends, another season of sport begins, to keep your mind always focused on something that don't give nothing to you. Now, I love basketball. I love track and football and boxing and all of that. And when I sit down and watch a good fight, you know, I really like Tiger Woods. I like him too. But I really like Felix Trinidad. And the way Felix took care of business. Now wait, I got joy out of that, you know what I mean? But I didn't get nothing else. After the fight was over, Felix went back to Puerto Rico, happy champion. I went back to the problem that I had before the fight came on. And you went back to whatever problem you're dealing with. The fight didn't help you solve your problem. The fight did not make you a better person. The fight did not give you more knowledge and understanding of life. It just gave us a little temporary relief from the problem to watch somebody beat up somebody. Now, sisters, you're not interested in that. But you may have been interested in one life to live, or, you know, as the world turns. You may have been interested in what went on in the soaps, and you sitting there glued to the TV. rent not paid, house not clean, you know. And after you turn it off and know what happened to Susie May or Susie Q or Jim Dandy, you turn the TV off, you say, well, oh, isn't that something? You call your friend, child, did you see the way the thing ended today? But what did it put in your pocket? What did it put in your head? What did it do to relieve you of the condition that 400 years of injustice and slavery and inhumanity have put us in? It didn't do nothing for you. So the world, like right now, you know, LA Lakers played last night, and the real game to watch was LA and the Spurs, and those of you who are into basketball, you know, I sat too. And I watched part of the game. When the game was over, I didn't have one nickel more than I had when the game started. I didn't have one more ayat of verse of scripture or knowledge. It did nothing for me but relieve me of serious thought for a moment. So the world in which we live is a world that keeps you revolving in that which is meaningless for your life. It's a world of sport and play. Now, sisters, you may have said you didn't look at the soap, but you're involved in stupidity too. Excuse me. Ain't got nothing to do with Jesus. You went downtown shopping. And don't you love to go in the mall and look at what you can't buy? Sometimes you spend hours just going looking, trying on something. Ain't got no money. But what did you get out of that? Nothing. Then you end up buying something. That's the style of a degenerate. I'm not mocking, but you're wearing heels too high, and they're disturbing your health, but you don't know that yet. You're wearing clothes too short. What kind of world is this? Why would a grandmother want to wear some mini something? Why, Grandma? Come on now. No, no, wait, I'm not trying to be smart. I'm not trying to be funny. But why would you dress like that? See, it's a world of sport. You're trying to catch somebody. See, it's fishing. I'm fishing for a man, so I got to dress a certain way. So the adornments that God has given me for my husband, I can't wait to show it off. See, it's sport. I go to the disco for what? What you go there for? Well, I go to dance, but dance for what? What is your motive? What are you doing it for? You're doing it for what? Look at yourself. Look into yourself. This is why Satan's world have reduced humanity to a joke. And that's why the rulers of the world can rule and give you injustice after injustice, and you have no power to stop them because your minds are not focused on what it should be focused on. Our minds are focused on sport, on play, on getting a woman, trapping a man, trapping a woman, getting high, partying, going to a dance, getting drunk, acting a fool,
and then talking about what a good time you had last night. That's your life. Brothers, sisters, the Satan is happy. He makes the liquor, you drink it. He finds a purpose for the weed, you smoke it. This dude is so pleased to create disease. And then the drug manufacturers discover a pill for the disease oftentimes that they create. So now when we get up in age, we, how did I say that? When we get up in age, you go into bed and waking up with a pill. You got a box of pills by your bedside. I gotta take this one, I gotta take that one, I gotta take this one and that one. In order to do what? In order to function in a world of sport and play, to prolong a life that hardly has any meaning. When they come with natural remedies for some of these illnesses, the drug companies go to the government. And they'll outlaw a natural remedy so that the drug company can make money from our illness. Just look at the world in which you live. We live. They know you and I gonna have sex. They know that. The thing that they wanna know is, are you gonna have the baby? Or you gonna have an abortion? They got the abortion clinic over here, and the hospital over here, and the bill they write. So you can't even bring a baby in the world without going into debt. Boy, that's a heavy thing to think about. And you can't die and return to the earth without debt. So they're commercializing on every natural desire that human beings have. They know you should love your mother. So they make a holiday so they can make money off of your love of your mother. Buy her this, get her that. Then after Mother's Day, it's Father's Day, then Valentine's Day, then Christmas, then Easter. But all of it is designed to take what you have naturally and profit from it while you get nothing in return but debt and slavery and grief and sorrow and stress and hypertension and high blood pressure and diabetes and cancer and AIDS and syphilis and gonorrhea. This is your life. It's a heck of a thing, man, to wake up in a life like this. And that's why the righteous people have never loved this world, because this world is not of God. We hunger and thirst for a world that is ruled by the righteousness of God. You agree?
Yes, sir.
Now let's look a little further. This period of darkness . If you look at the earth in winter, the earth is frozen
And this is the way humanity is. You're frozen in your state of development. You are not what you could be, not what you should be, and not what in your dreams you know you can be. And that's what Satan's world is all about. It's about freezing human potential, where a few of us get through and express our potential, and the others are frozen. All they can do is look at others, get some measure of greatness, and envy and hate them for their greatness. But the greatness that you see in anybody is sitting right up inside you. But Satan's world got your greatness frozen. And this is why Jesus is so important. The real knowledge of Jesus. Because when you know Jesus, he's the key to open and free the human potential. And once the human potential is freed, Satan can't rule no more. So Satan has to cover Jesus up, lie about Jesus, deceive you about Jesus, so you will have his name, but you will never have the power that goes along with that name. And I'm saying this to my Christian family. You have the name, beloved, but you don't have the power that goes with that name. If you had the power that goes with the name Jesus, you would be free. You wouldn't talk about oppression. You wouldn't be talking about racial profiling. You wouldn't be talking about the things that we naturally talk about, because we don't really have the power to stop it. But if you knew Jesus, I mean really knew him, what is wrapped up in that name, if you understood it, would give each believer the power to overturn the world of Satan, starting with ourselves, in our homes, in our communities, in government. We'd have Satan on the run if he really understood. So now we have to see what it is that we don't understand. Now this Jesus, he is the resurrector of the human family from spiritual death. This is an important man. All of us are under the death of Satan, the curse of the fall of Adam. This man, Jesus, he resurrects human beings from a state of spiritual death. That's a great function. He breaks down the wall that has separated man from God. And he reconciles man to God. So he's a redeemer, he's a reconciler, he's a savior. A redeemer in that he pays a price to free the people from the grip of Satan. Now, anything that you want in this life, there's a price for it. The greater the thing that you want, the bigger the price. You want a toy? There's a price for a toy. Thank you. You want a car? That's bigger. The price is bigger. You want a house? That's bigger. Price bigger. You want to be a servant in government? Price bigger. You want to be free? The price. If you're not willing to pay the price, then continue as you are. But there's a price that we have to pay.
So this man, Jesus, he comes to free humanity, but he also comes to pay a price. But it don't mean you don't have a price to pay. See, Christians, don't think that Jesus pays the price for our redemption and we don't have anything to do now but just ride on his coattail. No. No, that's not the way it goes. He pays a price, and if you choose to follow him, you got to pay a price. There is nobody who follows Jesus, really follows Jesus, who doesn't have a price to pay. You're going to be evil spoken of. You're going to be lied on. You may be brought into court falsely. You may be sent to prison falsely. You may even be put to death just to follow Jesus, because Satan don't want Jesus to have no real followers. So you that are in the church, that don't mean you a follower. That means you're a believer. Those of you that are in the mosque, that don't mean you're a follower. No, you're no follower. You can just say, I believe in what the man is saying is right. But if you're going to follow him, then there you got to pay a price. Do you understand what I'm saying? This man is a savior, because in what he brings to those who would believe and follow him, it is to save you from the destructive fall of Satan and his world. Now, you may not want to believe it, but this world is going down. You may not want to recognize it, but this world is going down, brother. And soon, and very soon, there'll be blood running in the streets of America. Soon and very soon, this world is coming down. But if you don't know Jesus, you don't have the knowledge of how to save yourself from the fall of America and the fall of the white man's world and the fall of this world, you're not listening to me. Now, for the first time, I said the fall of the white man's world. You say, well, wait a minute, Farrakhan, are you dealing in racism? I wouldn't waste my time. But just a minute. This is his world. He's the boss. You don't think he's the boss? Come on now. You don't think he's the boss? He ain't my boss. I bet you he is. Hey, look here. What you killing somebody over? Who picked you on this? Is it yours? Who's the boss? See, it's him and his money that spends. Go home. If you're the boss, go home and make some currency. And take your currency with your picture on it. Or even put Garvey's picture, put Martin King's picture, put Malcolm's picture, put Elijah's picture on it, and go on and see if you get anything for that. This is the white man's world. You have your social security number? Come on, talk to me. You do? Where's your credit card? Who gave it to you? Huh? Yeah. It's his world. Did you go to school? Who gave you your diploma? What did you study? You got a degree? Who conferred it on you? It's his world. He's the boss. You working? Who you working for? Federal Express? You downtown in an office building? Who's the boss? You got a job as a policeman? Who's the boss? You say you're a good Christian? Who's the boss? Well, I go to a black church. I didn't ask you that. I said, who's the boss? You ain't got a black Jesus up there. Who's the boss? If you a black Jew, white Jews run it. If you a black Muslim, white Arabs run it. The world is run by the Caucasian or white people. This is their world. And it is not a good world. They suffer in their own world. It's not hate. It's reality. Some of you call yourself preachers, and you got a license. Who issued you the license? You say you're in business. What are you buying and what are you selling? Who gave you the license? Well, I got a corporation. You do. Who validated your corporate status? Huh? He's the boss. This is his world. He makes you respect him in his world. The reason why Jesus is hated is because he is not of this world. He comes bringing in a whole new world. And that's why the people don't want Jesus, because if you want Jesus, you want out of this world. Jesus is a reconciler. He reconciles man with God, bringing about an accord, a harmony, and a oneness with God. When you are in accord with God, in harmony with God, one with God, that's life, that is power, that is the source of goodness and wisdom and strength, and you're free. This is why Jesus is so important to Muslims, to Christians, to Jews, to the whole of humanity, because all of humanity has been touched by the blinding touch of Satan. And Satan, according to the Bible, has deceived the whole world. Okay. Now, please listen. Jesus also saves us from the false teaching of Satan that has sentenced us to death mentally, morally, spiritually, and an untimely physical death. You go over in the projects and you talk to some of our young brothers who see death daily.
They live with guns. They live with violence. They live with death. And you ask them, how long do you expect to live? And the little brother will tell you, I don't think I'll make 21. Now you think about that kind of mentality in our children, that they don't think they'll live to be 21, to marry, to have children, and to help rear their own children. They don't see that. They see death. So don't tell me you have a savior if he cannot save you from an untimely death. In order to do that, he has to change the way we eat. He has to change the way we think. He has to change the way we live. And in doing that, he can extend your days, give you life and abundance of life. Well, I would like to become a follower of such a man. And there's no human being who knows the value of Jesus who would not wish or desire to follow him, to be with him. And Satan knows that too. Hell, if I'm in pain, I need a painkiller. When they cut me up in the hospital, they had morphine in a bottle. And I had a thing in my hand that when I felt the pain, I just pushed the button and I would get a shot. I had to be careful how many shots I took so that I didn't come out of the hospital sick in another kind of way. So they were surprised when they measured the morphine that I hardly took any. They were begging me to take some. Take some. I said, well, hell, if I was not in pain, what I need to take it for? They had cut me up all right, but I wasn't in that kind of pain. By the blessing of God. But if you're in pain, you're looking for a painkiller. If you're in disharmony and discord, you're looking for somebody that can come and make peace between people who are fighting and arguing with one another. I've been invited to speak at the Hip Hop Summit in New York, where all of the major rappers in the country will be there, and the record executives will be there. And they've asked me to deliver the keynote address. Wait, they don't know what I'm going to say, but I think I have an idea of what Allah wants me to say. Now look, there are rappers that are fighting with each other, and they want Farrakhan to be a mediator. Bring peace between the brothers and the sisters who are at odds with one another. Well, that's good. I like that job. Because the scripture says, blessed are the peacemakers, for they shall be called the children of God. Well, these young people in the hip-hop culture have literally rejected the culture, the style, the way, the norm of their parents. They're in a thing altogether new and different, and it's their thing, and they really don't care whether you like their thing or not. They're in their world. Now, you may say that's bad, but I know what I'm looking at. I'm not going to say that today. I'll save that for the Hip Hop Summit. But somebody thinks I may be coming there to condemn these brothers and sisters, not me. Jesus didn't come into the world to condemn the victims. He came into the world to point Satan out as the object of condemnation. Now, there was a man who was among us 2,000 years ago. His name was Jesus. A wonderful man. A beautiful human being. This Quran said he was a perfect example of the law of Moses. Now that we need to just stop a minute. Because if the law of Moses is found first in the Ten Commandments, and then in the laws that you find in Leviticus and Deuteronomy and other books of the Pentateuch, as they call it, the first five books of the Bible, if Jesus was a perfect example of that law, he was an extremely good human being. Now, there's a book out called The 100 Most Influential Men of the Present World, not written by Muslims. Do you know who number one is? Number one, they say, is Muhammad ibn Abdullah, the son, the Prophet of Arabia, is number one, the most influential. I think Newton, I believe it was Newton, who was number two, Isaac Newton, I believe. Third was Jesus. Sixth was Paul. Now they had Jesus as number three. That's interesting. Because the earth is the third planet from the sun, and yet it is the key planet of the nine. Jesus number three, but why ain't he number one? Jesus, the prophet, would never have been known if Paul did not make him known, because Jesus did all his preaching in the tiny state called Palestine, among the Jewish people. That was his assignment. Listen, he never ventured out of Palestine to teach. He grew up in Egypt, but he didn't teach in Egypt. He taught in Palestine among the Jews.
who rejected him. I want you to listen to me. According to what the Honorable Elijah Muhammad taught us, that Allah taught him, Jesus never taught more than 35 or 36 people at one time. He never taught multitudes. But the scripture says there is a Jesus in here that taught multitudes. I said there's four Jesuses under that one name. Maybe five, but I won't deal with that. Wait. I really want you to try and help me get through this. Paul, in speaking of Jesus, he saw him as a man born out of due season. If you go to your dictionary and look up the word due, it means whatever is due is immediately owing, having reached the date for payment. You know what that is, don't you? Ask the gas company. I mean, but it also means expected to be ready, to be present, or arrive. If Jesus was a man born out of due season, what was Jesus preaching? He was preaching the kingdom of God. 2,000 years ago, the kingdom has not arrived yet. So Jesus was a man preaching the kingdom out of the scheduled time of its arrival. So Paul saw Jesus as a man born out of due season. Jesus planted the seed of the kingdom. But somebody would come at the end of Satan's rule to not only water it, but to make the kingdom of God manifest on earth. Please don't look for the kingdom to come in the sky. Now, those of you who are hurrying away to the sky, may I please call you back from this journey? Wait, I want you to hear me. Don't get angry. I'm trying to clear away ignorance. Heaven has never been in the sky. No. Do you pray the Lord's Prayer? You do, Christians? Well, let's remember what it is. Our Father, which art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come. Thy will be done. Where? Where? Say it again. As it is in heaven. So the kingdom of God is coming to the earth. And believe it or not, Jesus said the kingdom
is within you.
Uh-oh. Now, I wonder who he was talking to. Was he talking to the El Rookins? Yes, he was. Was he talking to the black gangster disciples? Yes, he was. Was he talking to the Latin kings? Yes, he was. He was talking to those that you consider the worst of human beings, yet he said the kingdom of God is within you. What did he mean? What did he mean? See, each one of you is made or created in the image and the likeness of God. So at the core of your being, God is. But Satan has been the teacher. That's why the scripture said, we were born in and shaped in iniquity. That's not you. You are not sin and you are not iniquity, but you were born in it and shaped after it. So the kingdom is buried within you. And this is why the Jesus that we should be looking for is a man that says the first Adam was made from the dust of the earth, but the second is made from a quickening spirit. Quickening means that somebody comes to give life to the power of God that is within you. And then the first fight you have after you know the truth is to overthrow the government of Satan in your head, in your heart. Now, you want a real fight? You want to see a real rumble in the jungle? Take on that crazy mindset that you have that is of Satan, and let the God within be resurrected, given power to cast off Satan within. And once we've cast that bandit off within, then we can deal with him wherever we find him. But the first person that got to carry that fight is each one of you and me individually. All right, let's go on. Now, though Jesus planted the seed or the idea, the thought of the kingdom, he was 2,000 years too soon, in that Satan had 2,000 more years to continue his rule over the people of the earth. So darkness prevailed over the Jesus of 2,000 years ago, over the disciples of 2,000 years ago, and the work of those men 2,000 years ago. Satan's power has dominated the church. Now listen to me, dear Christians. The Pope recently went to Greece trying to patch up some differences that are thousands of years old in the Christian family, right? Yes, the Pope. Paul said, is Christ divided? Christ isn't, but the church is. Talk to me. So if the church is divided,
is responsible? Satan is in the church. Satan is in the mosque. Satan is in the synagogue. Because the Muslims are divided, the Jews are divided, the Christians are divided. Satan, thus far, has prevailed. Well, that's one Jesus. But the clearest and most beautiful idea that this Quran gives you of the man 2,000 years ago is in these words. Jesus and his mother were a sign. Bring the blackboard, please. I'm gonna go down. Oh, you can hear me now. Now, remember how we said that this world starts with Adam? 4004 BC? That's where the Genesis starts, 4004 BC. We're in 2001. So that's a little over 6,000 years, right? So all the religious scholars agree that 6,000 years is the term given to Satan to rule. So the first 2,000 years, you have a prophet, a major prophet, called Moses. Now, 2,000 years later, you have a major prophet, though he only taught in Palestine, Jesus. Now, the Quran, which was revealed 7 centuries after Jesus, speaks of Jesus and says Jesus and his mother were a sign. Any of you ever been on the road? Driving from here to Alabama? I must have hit somebody. If you got lost, you didn't follow the sign. Because the first thing you want to do, if you don't know the way, you call AAA. How do I get from here to Alabama or from here to Mississippi?
Take 57 going south. Or get on 65, going toward Indianapolis, then on to Nashville and down into Tennessee. And right in Tennessee, you can drop right down into Alabama. But if you want to go straight down to Mississippi, you stay right on to Memphis. And keep right on till you get in to Mississippi. But if you're a driver, you gotta watch for. You don't stop at the sign.
and say, I have arrived. The sign is pointing to or toward where you have to go. If Jesus and his mother were a sign, who and what were they a sign of? Now, I'm going to repeat some things that you heard me say a few weeks ago, because repetition is all part of teaching. If Jesus is a sign, he's pointing to one who's coming at the end of the world. Okay, who are we expecting at the end of the world, which comes 2,000 years after Jesus? Add it up, 2, 4, 6. So now, we are at the time of the expected one. Who's coming? Who is coming that Jesus was a sign of? Now we get three more people under the name Jesus. I want you to follow me. Okay? Under the name Jesus, you have the coming of God. Under that same name, Jesus, God coming. Because in the Jesus that comes is the indwelling Spirit of God. Who do you expect coming? Well, the Bible calls him the Son of Man. Let me put these names down. Coming of God. Son of Man. Christians, who are you looking for? Jesus, Messiah. Jews, who are you looking for? Messiah. Muslims, who are you looking for? Mahdi. Mahdi. All these under one name, Jesus. When God comes out of hiding, he has a purpose. So the scripture says, thou wentest forth for the salvation of thy people. Now you got a man, a man, a man, a people. What condition is this people in that it would require the coming of God? Y'all all right?
Yes, sir.
Good. In the book of Genesis, let's go back a minute. The 26th verse of chapter 1. And God said, let us make man in our image, after our likeness. Let us give them power, dominion over the fowl of the air, the fish of the sea,
and every creeping thing that crawls upon the earth. And that man was called Adam. But Adam is not an individual. Adam is a race of people. Male and female. Created he them. Fifth chapter of Genesis. And called their name Adam. Listen, listen, listen. And those of you who want to check this out, go to your library and ask for the pre-Adamites. Pre means before. Because the pre-Adamites are the us. That man was made in the image and likeness of, and the pre-Adamites, out of which Adam came, Adam and his people would rule them until the coming of God. Now, this might get a little sticky. Now listen, 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 please. Please. If you look at the pre-Adamites, they're called the aboriginal people of the earth. Ab is a Latin prefix meaning from or away from, origin meaning the beginning. And those people are the darker people of the earth are called the aboriginals. Are you a member of that family?
Yes,
are you aboriginal?
Yes,
The scientists recently discovered that life began where? Say it again. One more time, please. Well, if life began in Africa, then the tree of humanity begins with the dark people. And it comes up. You're the first people of the earth. Just not to say you're better than any other people. Because today we're in the worst condition of any people on the earth. So there's no sense walking around saying I'm better because I'm first, because right now we're the last. But the Bible did say that he would come and choose the last. He would take the bottom rail. He would bring it up to the top. Isn't that right? He would take a foolish people and they would become the people of God. Well, wait a minute. Does this mean that God only has one people? No. Stop it. The God you read about in the Bible is a national God. The God of Israel. But the God that the Holy Quran speaks about, he's Rabbil Alameen. He's the Lord of all the worlds. So even though God may choose a specific people at a specific time, the purpose for choosing anybody is not for the individual, it is for those who would benefit from him, either a people or the totality of humanity. So when Jesus comes, he may come from a people, to a people, but his mission is to the whole of humanity. You got it?
Yes, sir.
All right, now, while you are looking at that board, I'm going to go back up and try to tie this all together so you can see why Jesus, if you just had the true knowledge of him, you would be free overnight.
In the Islamic tradition, Jesus and the Mahdi are together in the judgment of the world. In both Islamic and Christian prophecy, Jesus is to return and do a work that the Jesus of 2,000 years ago prefigured. Now I want you to pay very good attention to this part. Remember what I said about this world being a world of darkness? What lights do you see when the earth is in darkness? Moon and stars. See, God never wants you to be completely in the dark. So even though it's dark outside, you have moonlight, you have starlight. Now, that moon, when it is a full moon, you go out when there's a full moon, you see trees, if you live in the country, but you see things sort of shadowy because the moon can't make manifest fully what you're looking at. What did Paul say? I want to read what Paul said. Paul said in the 13th chapter of Corinthians, we know in part. He was a follower of Jesus. Are you listening to me?
Yes, sir.
If he's a follower of Jesus and he said, we know in part and we prophesy in part. But when that which is perfect is come, then that which is in part shall be done away. He said, now we see through a glass darkly, but then face to face. Now I know in part, but then shall I know even as also I am known. Well, if you see darkly, buddy, then you are not in the light of that one, that Jesus that said, I am the light of the world. So Jesus of 2,000 years ago was not the Messiah. He was a prophet. And the fact that his disciples knew in part and prophesied in part and saw darkly through the glass. Then Jesus represented the brightness of the moonlight, which never can give you the clear vision that the brightness of the sun can give. And so the Bible in the book of Thessalonians It says that day shall not come except there be a falling away first, and the man of sin be revealed, the son of perdition.
And he says, whom God will destroy with the spirit of his mouth on the brightness of his coming.
So Jesus is talking about one coming after him. Go and read John.
Jesus said, it is expedient for you that I go away. For if I go not away, the Comforter cannot come unto you. But if I go away, I will send him unto you. And he shall come in my name.
See? So Jesus is saying, I'm going. And he even says in the Bible, I go to my Father, and you shall see me no more. Go read it. It's in your Bible. You see me no more. So the Jesus of 2,000 years ago went the way of all the prophets. You won't see him again, but he was a sign of what you would see coming.
At the end of the world. So, my dear brothers and sisters, Jesus of 2,000 years ago was a prophet who prefigured the Messiah.
The Honorable Elijah Muhammad said he never died on a cross. He died in the form of a cross.
I want you to hear me well. Listen to these words, so-called, of Jesus when he was on the cross. Eli, Eli, lama sabachthani. What does it mean? My God, why have you forsaken me? Those are not the words of that Jesus who knew God and was one with God. He knew that God would never forsake him. But there's another Jesus here that didn't know like that Jesus knew. Let's go look at it. Now, these subject matters that I take time to expound on or explain, you might not understand it all right now. But I'm giving you something to feed on. Understanding will come shortly. I'm going to say a few more things, and then you think about it, and you won't forget. You're not going to forget what I'm about to tell you. And no matter where you are, it's going to come to you. I promise you that. All right, now, the Jesus that comes at the end of the world uses this language. I am the light of the world. Ooh. That ain't no moon, baby.
When a man says he's the light of the world, Jack, you in the presence of the sun. And you know, when I left you all a few weeks ago, I was a lot lighter than I am now. But I got some sun. And I don't have to tell you that I've been somewhere. Because when you look in the skin and you see it got dark, you say, oh, minister got some sun. What does that mean?
Nothing remains the same in the light of the sun, and no one remains the same who is touched by the light of the Jesus of this book. Now let's tie this up. Now, to you that are here in this classroom today, you know, Farrakhan is quite capable of some real Bible thumping. Wait. Have you shouting and...
Yes, sir, yes, sir!
And you go out of here maybe just as dumb as you were when you came in. See, I'm not that kind of man. I don't care 2 cents for applause. I don't care one penny for shouting, teach on, teach on. That's what I'm gonna do anyway. What I care about is you. That when I leave you and you leave me, you are a bit more in knowledge than you were when we met each other. That's what I'm concerned about. And that I can't measure by this.
Teach on, brother, teach!
I can't measure that. But you know how I will measure? I will measure it by the response that comes from you in the life that you choose to live after you hear these words. That's more important to me than applause, you know. Because if you teach for effect, you know, well, you get that. But that's vanity. I say this to anybody who is in the ministry. Don't teach for applause. Don't preach for praise of men. Preach to see people elevated in consciousness, that they become more reflective of God and the truth that you represent. That's the motive of a good preacher. Lovest thou me, Peter? Master, you know I love you. Feed my sheep. Not some cankered cheese from the government. Not a soup line. Give the people the truth that quickens the Spirit of God within, so that the kingdom that is within can start coming up. And when you see men that hated one another, men that disrespected their women, men that were low life, vile men, violent men, berserk kind of men, when you see the Spirit of God coming up in them and they become seekers after knowledge, humble, then they start changing their moral character. Then they start looking at their wives as not objects of pleasure, but a serious creation of God. Then they begin molding their family better. Now you're seeing the kingdom of God coming up out of people and being planted in the earth. And this is what we are after. Prophet Muhammad, in the 33rd surah of the Qur'an, is likened to
a light-giving sun, S-U-N. That means that the light of this book, Qur'an, is a bright, bright light. It can dispel darkness and ignorance if understood. Prophet Muhammad revealed, God revealed this book through him. It had enough light in it to move the forces of darkness and all but conquered them, but didn't quite do it. Wasn't yet enough light, because it yet was not time. Look at the Prophet Muhammad, what he said. The sun that you see rising in the east, you will see it rising from the west. This does not mean that the sun is going to reverse its course, but it means that the light and the presence of God that was seen in the prophets in the east, you will see the brightest presence of God and the light of his wisdom coming up out of the west. Listen. The people of the east are much more civilized than the people of the west. Even without the knowledge of Jesus, China, Japan, Korea, you go among those people before Christianity, before Islam, you will see a higher level of civilization. When I see my Korean family, my Japanese family, my Chinese family, you go among them, you see them when they meet one another, they bow. What is that? What is that? It is a measure of respect for a fellow human being, a measure, a greater measure of respect for their leaders, their rulers. Bow. In the West, well, nobody bowed to nothing. Hey, how you doing? You meet a great one in the West? Hi. Hey, hey, hey. But in Africa, when you meet a great one, they bow. They kiss his shoulder. Because on the shoulders of the great one is carried the responsibility of governance. May I share something with you? When I was in Africa, the Yoruba king was over maybe 15 or more million people. He was in England, and he learned that Farrakhan was coming to Nigeria. He came back from England, and I went to visit him. When I saw the Yoruba king,
He came and his page carried a sword, gold and steel, with engraving of his name in the steel. And that sword was the symbol of his power of life and death over the Yoruba people. When they saw the king, the leaders came, they did not bow, they prostrated themselves before him, meaning that they were in total and complete obeisance to the greatness of this king. He took my wife and myself, and he had his people take us upstairs in a room, and he robed us in a fabric that looked like it was gold woven in the fabric. And when I came downstairs, my wife and I, he installed us and gave us a Yoruba name, and his people prostrated before me. When I was leaving, the king was walking me to his car, and he said to the page, "Give him my sword." And the page looked at the king and did not move, because he knew that was the symbol of his authority. The king took it out of the hand of the page and gave it to me. And I have that sword at home in the palace. When I was in another state in Nigeria, they held for me what is called a durbar, which they've only held for the Queen of England, Prince Charles, Haile Selassie. And when Farrakhan came, even though it was the first day of Ramadan, in the heat of the sun, they decked their horses in silver and gold, and they lined over 150,000 of them. And they had a durba in my honor and gave me a beautiful white stallion. This I don't talk about. But we have it on film. And, you know, brothers and sisters, I don't make nothing special of myself. But you would be shocked to see the way your brother is honored in different parts of the world. A Muslim saint in Medina, 107 years old, whom the big sheikhs, rulers in Arabia, go to him and sit for hours with the donkeys and the sheep or whatever, until he's ready to see them. When he knew that I was in Medina, he sent for me. 107 years old. He has students all over the world. And when I came in his presence, I kneeled down at his feet
He didn't speak loudly, so I had to come close. And he said, Farrakhan, I have you on my mind about 500 times a day. Then he gave me some words of guidance and admonition. And then he said, I want you to come back and go to Hajj with me, that I may show you the proper respect and honor and hospitality that you are due. Don't applaud. He said, go downstairs and have some tea. And I went downstairs and they made me some tea. And then his son and his principal student came with gifts for me. And the gift was his cloak and his staff. Did you hear me? He was not present. I couldn't say no. I received it. When they took me back to my hotel, I asked his son, what is the meaning of this? He said, I've been with him for 40 years. I've never seen him do this for anyone. He's giving you the symbol of his authority. Did you hear me?
Yes, sir.
When I was in Russia, they held a parade for me and for us. They dressed in the garments of Genghis Khan, riding their horses with lamb's wool. And they cloaked me in the lamb's wool and put on my head their famous fezes and gave me gold and ruby swords. Why do you do this? They see a light coming up out of the west that challenges the power of America, that is not afraid to speak the truth and pay the price, even if the price is my death. I will go to my grave not bowing down to the satanic force of the United States of America. I want you to listen as I conclude. If the sun that was seen in the east would rise from the west, this means that the presence, power, light of God would be seen from the west, but it would be seen coming up out of a people who are considered dead. Follow me now, this is very important. Abraham made a prophecy. Listen. Or God caused Abraham to know when God spoke to Abraham, listen to his words. No. Of a surety, Abraham,
that your seed shall be a stranger in a land that is not theirs. And they shall serve them. And they, the stranger, shall afflict them for 400 years. But after that time, I, God talking, will come. I will come. And afterwards shall they come out with great substance. He will come and judge that nation that they shall serve. Now we got God coming and a people in bondage. That's the purpose for his coming. Now let's go. Come on now. I don't want you to go to sleep, boy. Damn it, if you sleep, wake up! If I had a stick, I'd come down and whoop your behind. Wake up! Don't go to sleep on your salvation. Wake up! All right, let's go. Matthew, 24th chapter. Come on, Christians. You ain't going to sleep on me now. Come on, you young people. You ain't too young to die. You're not too young to live and to come into the wisdom of God to make a real man out of you, young man. Ain't no sleeping time. If you see him sleep, go shake him. Put your arm on his shoulder. Wake up, wash your face. I don't mean it. I don't mean it like that, brothers. I just don't want you to sleep and miss this. Because now I'm coming to you. See, I've been talking about Jesus. You didn't know I was talking about you. Huh? What I got to do with it, that's the secret. Hang in there with me, people.
Now you got the Son of Man. Matthew 24th chapter, as lightning shines from the east even unto the west, so shall the coming of the Son of Man be. God coming out of the east, he's coming to the west. What you coming for? He said, wheresoever the eagles are gathered together, there shall the carcass be. Now let me get to the definition of a carcass. You know, it's the dead body of an animal or the dead body of a human being or the body of a slaughtered animal after removal of the offal. A carcass is anything from which life and power are gone. What are you coming for, Son of Man? I'm coming for a carcass. I'm coming to a people whom the spirit of life and power are no longer seen in them. I'm coming to a people who've been 400 years under the clutch in the hand of a strange people who have afflicted them for 400 years. They're in a nation that I'm going to judge. It just so happens they're in a nation that's the most powerful nation on the earth, that all the nations of the earth bow down to, make reverence to, the United States of America. Now I want you to wake up and listen to your future. The one that comes from the east unto the west is coming to do a specific work. That work will bear witness to his presence in the world. Who is he that comes? His name is Jesus. It's another name for the God, see? Son of Man. But then, if you look in the 37th chapter of Ezekiel, Ezekiel, let's look at the 37th. Come on now. We're in a class. Wake up. Here it is. He said, the hand of the Lord was upon me and carried me out in the spirit of the Lord and set me down in the midst of the valley, which was full of bones, and caused me to pass by them round about. And behold, there were very many dry bones in that valley. See, the dry bones, that means the remains, a carcass, you see? A people that once was somebody, but the spirit of life and power is no longer in them. And he that carried me about, look into his words, he said, Son of Man. So here's a son of man coming out of the east, but now there's a son of man among the bones. So the man, the son of man that comes out of the east to the west, comes to a people, he raises one from that people who is also a son of man. So you got a Jesus coming. And he comes to a people who are dead. And he raises one from the dead. And he becomes a son of man, a Jesus. Now he's got to go to a people who are in bondage for 400 years, and their condition is so bad, he asks the question, can these bones live? With me today is my dear brother and friend, Bishop Kim. And some of the beautiful followers of the Reverend Sun Myung Moon. I'm going to be a bit presumptuous to say that my Asian family, when they come among us and look at our condition, the question can be asked, can these bones live? Reverend Moon just completed, and Mother Moon, I think an 18-city tour. 52 cities, thank you, Reverend Kim, Bishop Kim, 52 cities. In less than 2 months, he's 80 some years old, 81 I think,
but strong, strong, strong. And in those 80, in those 52 cities, he spoke mostly to us. Can these bones live? I don't know what his impression of us is, but I know that the bones are dry. And I know that among us, the language that we use, look at this. When the Son of Man was asked, can these bones live? He said, Lord, only you know. Now that means I'm looking at something that's so difficult. You ask me a question, can they live? I said, Lord, only you know what could happen with these bones. And then he said, well, prophesy unto these bones and say unto them, O ye dry bones, hear the word of the Lord. Thus saith the Lord God unto these bones, behold, I, God talking, will cause breath to enter into you, and you shall live. And I will lay sinews upon you and bring up flesh upon you and cover you with skin and put breath in you, and you shall live, and you shall know that I am the Lord. So I prophesied as I was commanded, and as I prophesied, there was a noise, and behold, a shaking, and the bones came together, bone to his bone. And when I beheld, the sinews and the flesh came up upon them, and the skin covered them above, but there was no breath in them. Every great leader that has come among you has talked to you, and you shake. When Mr. Garvey spoke to you and me, we shook. And the enemy was afraid, because he said, if the bones come together, they may remember what we did to them. So they never want to see you unite. That's the point. Garvey came, Du Bois came, Nat Turner, Denmark Vesey, Sojourner Truth, huh? The Black Moses, Harriet Tubman, all of them fought for you, and you betrayed them all. Cowardly, gutless people, that when somebody comes with strength, instead of you standing up, recognizing that strength and drawing strength from that strength, you become afraid of them, because the white man then will punish you for listening to a black leader that they don't control. I'm almost finished. So you have one Jesus, the prophet that was a sign. Now you've got the coming of God, the real Jesus. Then he presents himself quietly. Oh, I wish I had time to tell you how the God came and was among us for 3 years and 4 months, raising one of our brothers up that would give life to us. At some other time, I will go into the scriptures and show you what it means when it says he came without observation, as a thief in the night. He came in sinful flesh.
to condemn sin in the flesh. Oh, brothers and sisters, this Bible can talk to you. If you understand it, you be free. All right. Now, the bones ain't got no breath in them. So the Son of Man went back to the God. You know? They're shaking, but there's no breath in them. He said, don't worry. He said, prophesy unto the wind. Prophesy, Son of Man, and say to the wind, thus saith the Lord God, come from the four winds, O breath, and breathe upon these slain, that they may live. And if you jump from Ezekiel to the book of Revelation, it says, hold back the four winds until I go down and seal my elect in their forehead with the seal, the knowledge of the living God. Now you've had time enough. You're not breathing. You're not alive. So it's time for the Son of Man that is among you to prophesy to the winds and let the four winds blow on you.
Mm-hmm. Almost finished. It is this third Jesus that was on the cross. Who is that Jesus? See, look at what has happened to you since our fathers were brought to America to be made slaves. You were stripped of your original garments. You don't wear those garments anymore. We don't wear them anymore, brother. Jesus was stripped. He was hung on a cross. He had a crown of thorns on his head. He's talking about an individual and a people. An individual that is crucified for you. There hasn't been one black leader that has come among you that the government and the rulers of this country have not crucified. Do you know what crucifixion was in the Roman Empire? It was a means of punishment of those guilty of treason or guilty of going against the state. So when they put you up on a cross and nail you, you hang there for hours, defecating and urinating on yourself. And those that hate you for your treason, they come by and they spit at you. They throw stones at you. And finally, after hours of being before the people, naked, wounded, right, you die. There hasn't been one black leader that came to you that the government of the United States didn't put on a cross. What do you mean, nail your hands? Look at your hands. Look at them. You say, I ain't got no nail in mine. Check them again. What have your hands done to free you? What have your hands done to build a future for yourself? You've been to school. You've got diplomas and degrees, but your hands are nailed in America. You can't do nothing to lift yourself out of the condition that white America has put you in. Your hands are nailed. What about your feet? Feet nailed. When you're in the lodge, you call yourself a traveling man. But if your feet are nailed, you can't go no place. Where I left you, I can come back and find you. That's the way you are, black man and woman. Your feet are nailed. Some of you grow up in the ghetto and you don't leave it until you die. You live in the south side of Chicago, you die in the south side of Chicago. You live in America, you haven't seen nothing. Some of you have never been out of the country. What's the matter with you? Nailed. And whatever position the white man put you in, he come back and find you in the same position. You haven't moved nowhere. You got black people in government, but you haven't moved. You got black people in positions of power, but you as a people have not moved. You were a nigger yesterday, and you a nigger today in the eyes of white America. Talk back to me. What is that on your head? What is that on your head? Oh, you are a natural king. In your heart, you know it. That's why when you dream about yourself as this and that. That's why when you wake up sometimes, you'll tell people you're God. I'm a prophet of God. Yes, I talked to God last night. You're dreaming. Because in your heart, you are descendants of God. And you don't deserve to be in the condition that you are in. But you're nailed. You're nailed. And a crown is on your head. But it's a crown of thorns. White folk told you, if you go to school and get an education, you'll be better off. You got a PhD degree. You're in corporate America, but you're still a nigger, a crown of thorns. You can be reverend. You can be bishop. But you had to go in Alabama and kneel down before the white man so you could sit in a nasty restaurant and be buried in a grave with your tormentor. Look at you. So your education has been a crown of thorns. You do everything to be better, to be respected. I'll go into business. I'll pull myself up by my own bootstraps. Yeah, this is what they did on Black Wall Street in Tulsa, Oklahoma. But the white man became so jealous and envious of their success. For the first time in American history, they went up in planes and bombed and destroyed the black neighborhood that was progressive and killed hundreds of us on the lie that a black man raped a white woman. A crown of thorns. join the army. You become a master sergeant, a lieutenant. Feel good about yourself and come back home with all your little medals on. And they find you hanging from a tree with all your medals because no matter what you've done for America, America don't respect you enough to respect your humanity. They find you hanging from a tree with all your medals because no matter what you've done for America, America don't respect you enough to respect your humanity. You a nigger in the army? You a nigger in the Navy? You a nigger in the Marine Corps? You a nigger in the Christian church because it's them same white Christians that discriminate against black Christians, and that's why you got a second Baptist church. The white folks is in the first Baptist, you in second Baptist. This is why you got the African Methodist Episcopalian church, because the Lutherans and all of them, they discriminated against you, yet they said they knew Jesus and they loved Jesus, but they were liars, they were deceivers. They told you if you registered to vote, you could be free. So you registered. And they found a way to rob you of the man you voted for. You know you didn't vote for Bush, but they robbed you. Even with your right to vote, they find a way to trap your aldermen, trap your leadership, trap your mayors. And it's the FBI that does it. The government agencies broke up black organizations, jailed black leaders, put us against each other. The government did this. You on Calvary right now, and it's only you that say, Eli, Eli, Lama Sabachthani, my God. Why have you forsaken us? He hasn't forsaken you, but you don't know that he's working out your salvation, but you crying out on the cross. Why have you let me down? What have I done to live like this, to die like this, to see my children destroyed like this? What have I done? Why have you forsaken me? You gave Moses to the Jews. You gave Daniel to the children in Babylon. You gave somebody to all those that were oppressed. Why have you forsaken me? And one nearby said, behold, he calls for Elijah. Let us see if Elijah will take him down. I bear witness, Elijah will take you down. Give me some water. The Bible closes the book of Malachi, which means my messenger. Behold, before the great and the dreadful day of the Lord, I will send you Elijah. He will turn the hearts of the children to the father and the hearts of the fathers to their children, lest I come and smite the earth with a curse. Then the New Testament opens on the genealogy of Jesus. But the Old Testament said his name will be called Emmanuel, which means God is with us. Us, us, us. Who is us? It's that same us in the book of Genesis that said, let us make man in our image and after our likeness, and let us give them power and dominion. You got power, the Caucasian, to rule everybody on the earth, but where did you get the power? You got it from us. We sent you prophets, raised you up. Now you master the sea, the sky, the earth. But you don't master it in righteousness. You have plundered the earth. You have poisoned the earth, the atmosphere, the water, the air, with your greed. You have destroyed the rainforests with your greed. But a God, a mighty God, said he would come and he would judge that nation that you would serve. And Elijah, who is a son of man raised up among the bones, he's a Jesus for you, because he can take you down off the cross. I met him. He taught me. I know him. He made me. I'm not like no other black man you ever saw or you ever heard. I'm a new black man. Elijah took the nails out my hand. Elijah took the nails out my feet. Elijah replaced a crown of thorns. And now I go anywhere in the world that I want to go. And when they ask me, are you going to these countries that we call rogue nations? I tell them I was not aware that I was on a plantation that I got to report to you. You heard me say it. The government said they were going to bring me before Congress. I said, don't threaten me. Bring me. There ain't nothing in Congress that can handle me. They don't have nothing that can handle me. It's not that I can't be handled, but when you calculate how you're gonna deal with me, you gotta calculate on what I depend on for my strength. And that you can't handle. And as long as I'm with him and they are with me, them Jesuses, then I become a little Jesus in your midst.
that's talking to multitudes. I'm the man that called the multitudes and they come. What black man do you know that ever called 1 million and 2 million showed up? Well, who am I? What am I? My father, Elijah, is a son of man, and I'm a man from a man. I too am a son of man. Yeah, open your Bible and read about him. I'm not bragging, I'm not boasting, but I have lived among you long enough for you to know that I'm not some Rudy poop that jumped up yesterday. Talk about myself. I let other people claim who they are, but my work bears witness of me. In Ezekiel 2:9, God is raising up a son of man. Told him, I'm sending you to a rebellious house. That's you. Their heads are hard. They got impudent looks on their faces. But don't be dismayed by their looks, because I've made your head like a flint stone. You see the flint stones on television? See, a flint is a stone that busts stones. I don't give a damn how hard you look at me, baby. I got the stuff to bust you up. Of you that know me, you never hear me talk about me. I represent him that raised me. But I think it's time that you know that he raised me up to sit in his seat, and he has given you to me as a nation for me to resurrect. You don't belong to nobody but God, his messenger, and me, and I'm coming to get what is mine. Gonna mistreat me and get away with it. I threaten the government. Whatever you want to do, come on and do it. I'll prove to you that I'm backed by God, and my God will wipe this country from the face of the earth. Well, Farrakhan, Is your God my God? I don't know. You represent some punctified milquetoast God that don't have no power to deal with the power of America, the power of England, the power of France, the power of the West, or the powers in the East? Hell no. I represent a God that will deal with you all. When the enemy knew that Jesus was to come and end their world, plots and plans for the destruction of that man began. The plot is always to kill the one that comes to end Satan's world. And since you are a people that God has chosen, not because of your righteousness, but he chose you out of the furnace of affliction. He promises he will purify us and wash us clean. Though your sins be as scarlet, he will wash them white as snow. Why? Because you, like Jesus, have a universal mission. You are a people that, in spite of what you've suffered, you have love in your hearts. You cry when you see the picture of the Jewish Holocaust. We cry. We cry when we see the slaughter of human beings that are not of our race. The Japanese are Aboriginal people. They're suffering today because they did something out of season. Their flag is the rising sun, because they were the first nation out of the East to move towards war with the beast of the West. Your flag, the rising sun, is that you represented a new day. The dawn of a new day. A new day for China. A new day for Korea. A new day for Asia. A new day for us. Because when we were in the war fighting against the Japanese, because we don't know you as our brother, we were the slaves of a white America. But when we were captured, the Japanese would look at us and say, same, same. Same, same. In other words, why are you fighting for your enemy? That's a good question. Why would you join the army of your enemy? If you're in it, get out of it. Because soon you'll be in a fight that you won't live from. He has a way of putting the poor on the front lines. The black, the Hispanic, the brown. You that claim your new right of citizenship in America, he'll make you do the fighting. Like when the Japanese attacked Pearl Harbor. See, we never understood what their reason was. And the Japanese Americans suffered. But they don't care that you're an American. you're Japanese, and maybe your loyalty will be to the emperor. Therefore, we put you in a concentration camp. Took all your property, took your money, took your life's work. But now they're willing to pay the Japanese reparations. But they have not offered you one dime for the 400 years.
When it comes time to talk for this, you be quiet.
God has raised somebody to speak for you that will not compromise your future. They can't buy me, and they can't frighten me out of telling you the truth. China has risen up as a communist force in the world. Don't worry about China. She's anti-religious. She's right. What kind of religion are you going to offer China? The same religion that you used to enslave Africa? To enslave Central and South America? What kind of religion are you gonna offer the people? Hell, you better go on home and offer religion to your sinful and wicked self. Who the hell are you to come and offer us anything about God with the wickedness of your life? You arrogant hypocrite. Damn it, if you want to preach God, you go down in Mississippi and Georgia and Alabama, Louisiana, and tell them crackers down there about a God of love. Because we know them. There ain't no love in them people for you and me. Talk back to me, black man. You say Farrakhan is a hater. No, I'm a lover. I love truth. I love God. I love this people that this world has destroyed. And I have love in my heart for righteous people, no matter what their color or their race. If you're gonna live according to God's law, I love you. You are my brother, my sister. We are family, regardless of your color or your race. Now let's wrap this up. Since the enemy knows your future, that you have a great future, they have decided to destroy you as well as me. So now, death is working overtime against the black man and woman of America. Death is working overtime against the blacks of Africa. Look at you. You fill the funeral parlors. Because of your ignorance, they put guns in your hand, though you don't manufacture nothing. But all of you got a gun somewhere. You don't have it for your oppressor. You have it for your brother who don't wear the same color or flash the same gang sign as you. They're filling the prisons with you and then forcing you to have sex with another man to destroy your manhood
in the prison. They make you a guinea pig of experimentation in the prisons. And they have you on death row, and many of you are not guilty. The court system is against you. The jury system is against you. This world is against you. But God is for you. And if God be for you, who can be against you and win?
So now the gangbangers want peace. The hip hoppers are leading youth all over the world.
They've become an object of fear because the white people have lost control of their children. Now their children walk in the street with their pants down on their behind. Their children dreadlocks. White folk with dreadlocks. My wife and I were turning the TV the other night, and this rap group, NSYNC, came up. I said, let's watch them. And as NSYNC was going, my wife said, that's Michael Jackson's move. That's Janis Jackson's move. That's Paula Abdul's move. Put your hand in the air. Whoa, whoa. And there, all these young white children. And their own fathers don't understand the children. Children got you as an idol. I listen to them sing, I hear you. I see them dance, I see you. I hear them play the horn and I hear you. I hear them singing the blues and I hear you. You coming all up out of America because God is raising you up degree by degree. You the best in basketball, you the best in baseball, you the best in boxing, you now the best in golf, you coming to be the best in tennis. Anywhere they put you, you become the best. Why? Because God is raising you in your house of bondage. So, in my conclusion, at last, I know you can't take all of this, but I'm not preaching for today. I'm preaching as a witness against you. You'll never be able to tell God you didn't hear. Because after you hear, you're responsible for what you know. So you and I are said to be living in the very valley of the shadow of death. And the only way you can escape the death that is planned for you and me is to accept the Lord as your shepherd. I can say with truth, the Lord is my shepherd. I really don't want for anything that God has not shown me a way to get or that He will give me. He leadeth me by the still waters. Because no matter what's going on, I'm at peace. At peace with God, at peace with myself. And I'm at peace because I'm doing
his will. He leadeth me in the path of righteousness for his name's sake. And he has restored my soul. And yea, though I walk in the valley of the shadow of death, I don't fear no evil. For the big Jesus, God Almighty in person, is with me. And that Son of Man that he raised from the dry bones is with me. And guess what? The righteous all over the planet see me as their brother. He prepared a table for me in the midst of my enemies. These people have called me anti-white, anti-Semitic, anti-Catholic, anti-gay, anti-American. And they've done everything to cut off any funds that would come to the Nation of Islam. And I told them, if you want to cut off my blessings, you have to get a ladder that will reach heaven. And I don't think you've got a ladder that tall. You'll never cut off my blessings. He anointed my head with oil, so much so till my cup runneth over. Surely goodness and mercy shall follow me and you all the days of our lives, and we will dwell in the house of the Lord forever. Beloved, I would like to end this talk with a scripture that Jesus, that is the third Jesus, the one that comes before the coming of God. He's referred to in the book of Revelations as the bright and the morning star. When you look toward the east, after the darkest hour of the night, you will see a star. It's a planet. It's called the morning star. And if you follow that star, it takes you right up into the light of the sun and gets lost in the light of the sun. It means that at the end of the night, one is coming that will lead you to the light, and both you and that one will get so lost in the light that you will become a nation like the sun itself. So I close this reading from the book of Isaiah. And it shall come to pass in the day that the Lord shall give thee rest from thy sorrow. Talking about you. And give you rest from your fear and from the hard bondage wherein you were made to serve, that you will take up this proverb against the king of Babylon, not the wicked city of ancient Babylon, but the mystery Babylon, which is the United States of America. You will take up a proverb against them, and this is what you will say. How hath the oppressor ceased? The golden city ceased, because the power of your God is going to stop his oppression, and the power and influence of America is going to weaken all over the earth. It is happening as we speak. Now listen, listen, listen. The Lord hath broken the staff of the wicked and the scepter of the rulers. That means those that rule us, their staff is broken and their scepter, meaning their authority, is being challenged now. He who smote the people in wrath with a continual stroke. He that ruled the nations in anger is persecuted now, and none hinders. You sent a spy plane over China. And they had to land in China. The big bad wolf. Give me back my plane, and don't you enter that plane. That's American property. The Chinese not only entered it, but they took everything of what they had spied and left in it, sent the troops back, and to see Bush giving them some little medal for spying. We're proud of you, soldiers, your character. A spy. China haven't sent no planes over here. But America feels that she has the right to spy on everybody. But look what the book says. He's persecuted now. They bombing his embassies. In Africa, in the Middle East, they attack his embassies now when he does that which the people don't like. It says the whole earth is at rest and is quiet. They break forth into singing. That day is coming when America's power is broken. There'll be a lot of folks singing, because she's the terrorist that terrorizes the earth. A suicide bomber went into a crowded store, blew himself up. You say he's a terrorist. To my Japanese family, the kamikaze pilots, they knew they were gonna die, but they strapped themselves in the plane and locked it. And they were given flowers. And their aim was to drive their plane right into battleships and the warships of America. Kill themselves. They were not foolish people. When the Vietnamese were sick of the French, sick of America, they would immolate themselves, pour gasoline on themselves, and sit down and burn themselves to death in protest. You know why? Because life has no meaning
without justice, without freedom, without equality. The Palestinians living under wretched conditions. You want Arafat to stop the violence? Arafat didn't start the violence. He's a product of the injustice of Israel. Castro was traveling last week and the week before. He was in Iran. He was in Algeria. He was in Syria. He was in Libya. Castro visited the Muslim world. Everywhere he went, they cheered him as one of the greatest revolutionaries on the earth. North Korea and the effort to unify North and South Korea. The enemy doesn't want that. South Korea has much to teach the North, but the North also has much to teach the South. One of the most disciplined societies in all of Asia. And the unity of North and South Korea, the unity of China and Taiwan, the unity of China and Japan will make a power in Asia. So the Japanese are saying to America, we need our own army again. We need our own navy again. Because in the peace treaty, America deprived them of the right to have an armed force to protect Japan. Now the Japanese say we want an army. You notice all the depleted uranium that was on several boats on its way to Japan. Japan says we want to build nuclear stations for electricity. My brothers from Japan are coming again. You have not heard from China. America says she's going to sell weapons to Taiwan. China said, don't do it. America says she would defend Taiwan. Don't you believe it? She ain't got the heart. She's a big punk. Let me tell you something. The soldiers don't know what the hell they're fighting for. How can you fight and don't have a just cause? You're an oppressor. You're an imperialist. You're a tyrant. Your people don't have any cause. That's why you had to dope them up in Korea, dope them up in Vietnam. They came back to America, drug addicts. But what were the Vietnamese fighting on? They were fighting on the love of freedom and the love of their country and to get the oppressor out, and they drove them out. They drove out the French. They drove out the Americans. But the worst is yet to come. Let's finish. The fir trees rejoice at thee and the cedars of Lebanon, saying, since thou art laid down, no fella is come up against us. Once America has been judged, there will be no other country to come up against the rise of the indigenous peoples of the earth. Look at this. Hell from beneath is moved for thee to meet thee at thy coming. Hell is stirring up the dead for thee, for God. Now look, the whole ghetto is troubled now. It's stirred up. What you stirred up for? It's like muddying the waters. The fish got to come to the surface to get air. Yeah, the ghetto hell is stirred up, brother. Even all the chief ones of the earth, and they shall speak and say unto thee, Babylon, have you become as weak as we? The Palestinians cry out, America, get back in the peace process. America knows that if that thing goes out of control, it will engulf the whole world. But America's timid. Well, we can't get in until the violence is stopped. How can you stop the violence when it's coming up from the people who say enough is enough? I'd rather be dead than to live under these conditions. Art thou become like us, America? Are you like all the rest of us weak nations? Thy pomp is brought down to the grave, and the noise of thy musical instruments is silenced. The worm is spread under thee, and the worms cover thee, which means she's in a state of death now. I close. O Lucifer, son of the morning, how art thou fallen from heaven that didst weaken the nations? For thou hast said in thine heart, I will ascend into heaven, I will exalt my throne above the stars of God. I will sit also upon the mount of the congregation in the sides of the north. Spiritually, it's talking about the Pope, and politically, it's talking about the government of the United States of North America. I will sit in the sides of the north. I will ascend above the heights of the clouds. I will be like the Most High. Yet thou shalt be brought down to hell, to the sides of the pit. And they that see thee shall narrowly look upon thee and consider thee, saying, is this the man that made the earth to tremble? Lucifer, son of the morning, the bright and the morning star. When God comes, the fight is on. Armageddon is not to come. Armageddon has already started. But the Honorable Elijah Muhammad said the battle will be in the sky. See, it just don't mean airplanes. See, the battle has already begun. The battle is for the mind. Satan battling for your mind, God battling for your mind, but that war that is in the sky will soon come to the earth, and you will see blood up to the horse's bridle. All of this is prophesied. And so, my beloved brothers and sisters, I would hope that as a people, you would not only love Jesus, but become a true follower. Yes, sir. Take up the mission. Yes, sir. Brothers, yes, sir. Take up the mission. Yes, sir. Don't just be a church goer. Yes, sir. Sitting down, listening to a good lecture, paying a little dues, and think that you've done your job. Help build a kingdom on earth. Go after your people. When you leave here today, don't go and kill your brother. Talking about he's in a different gang. That's your brother. He's flesh of your flesh. He's blood of your blood. He's bone of your bone. So let the bones come together. The winds are blowing. The winds of oppression are blowing. But breath will soon come into you. And the book says, and the dry bones stood up, an exceedingly great army. Amen. You know why they're angry with me?
Because they know that I am the CNC, the Commander in Chief of the Army of God, and they want to deal with me, but I'm not going to hide anymore about who I am and what my assignment is. I want you to help me raise up the dry bones in the valley so that we can become the people of Jesus. Jesus as the head, we as the body, doing his redemptive work all over the world. Jesus one, Prophet Jesus. Jesus two, God in person. Jesus three, the Son of Man raised from among you. Jesus four, the people of God. I'll stop there. You add number five. Number five is your brother that will stand in America calling and being a resurrector of the dead of our people. Thank you for listening, and may Allah bless you as I greet you in peace. Assalamu alaikum.
Allahu Akbar. Give a round of applause, the Honorable Minister Louis Farrakhan. Come on, Chicago. Let him hear it.
Brothers and sisters, as we like at this time, to recognize and ask Bishop Kim and the Japanese and Korean delegation that are visiting us this afternoon, could you come forth at this time? They have a presentation that they would like to make to the Honorable Minister Louis Farrakhan. Let us receive our Japanese brothers and sisters, Bishop Kim. Bishop Kim.
On behalf of Father and Mother Moon, we are very honored to be here today, celebrating one more time our minister's birthday. And I was a morning preacher. I don't know good preacher or bad preacher, but this afternoon, I believe I was a good student. Because my heart fully open, and I didn't miss any word of the minister. So thank you so much, great teaching. And Father Moon said, please congratulate our minister's birthday, and we really want well-being forever. And our Japanese missionaries, they made this 1,000 crane. It take over 3 months. Whenever they hold this special paper, they pray for minister. So when I do this, maybe it take over 1 year. So it means, it symbolize 1,000 years well-being and happiness and great teachings. Thank you so much, and God bless you.
All praises due to Allah. All praises due to Allah. Let's hear it for Bishop Kim, Reverend Moon, Father Moon, and Mother Moon, and their presentation to the Honorable Minister Louis Farrakhan.
Thank you.
This crane is a very beautiful bird. It has very great spiritual meaning. And I think, Reverend Moon, we represent a millennium that will bring peace and progress and justice and brotherhood to the human family. We represent that that will bring about true families, and out of the family, true family, will grow a nation that will never be removed from the earth. So I thank you, Bishop Kim, for this wonderful gift, and I thank my sisters from Japan for such beautiful gift. And I want them to know, the Japanese that are present, that I have, since a little boy, always felt a strong kinship to the Japanese. I don't know why, but as I grew older, I never sided with the wicked in what they did against Japan. And I don't know why, but the more I became knowledgeable of the Japanese, of their culture, I never wanted to see them throw away the beauty of their culture to accept the culture of decadence. You see? Although Japan needs much to be brought up to that which Japan is destined to be. But all of this is to say to you, brothers and sisters, that your people are going to come from all over the world to aid your rise, help you, and teach us the science and things that we have missed to make us a great people. This is what God has promised, and He will fulfill His promise. So I thank you. Now, I want to thank all of you who have come out to hear Minister Ismail Muhammad in my absence. I appreciate the fact that I was here with you last week and on what is called Mother's Day. And I hope you will get that lecture and study it, because there's a lot in it. And maybe you want to get the one today too. And the next time I come out, I will be talking about the birth, life, ministry, and death of Prophet Muhammad and what it means for us in the West today. Don't miss that lecture. And then the following week, I want to talk to you about the judgment. You know, Japan is very significant in the judgment. And there is a plane up above our heads that I want to talk to you about, that they call unidentified flying objects. We know what those flying objects are. They're very well identified. And we want to talk to you about them, about the wheel that is up there, about the civilization that is on that wheel, and what it represents for you and me and the world. So don't miss these lectures. And remember what I said. Don't come by yourself.